What is up, The Catch fam? My name is John Dawson. Today we will be bringing you our week 15 must add waiver wire additions. It is officially fantasy playoff time, so make sure you guys stay tuned if you want some help and who you should be adding heading into the first week of the playoffs as well. As those of you who did unfortunately not make the playoffs, stay tuned to find out how you can hurt some of those teams that kept you out the fantasy playoffs. Before we hop into today's content, I do kindly ask that you guys go ahead and smash that like button. Consider subscribing down below. We will have daily uploads as well as daily fantasy Q&A all week long and all throughout the fantasy playoffs here at The Catch. So go ahead and become part of The Catch fam today and feel free to drop any comments, questions, concerns pertaining to the 2021 fantasy football season down below, and I will happily respond to every single comment. Without further ado, let's get right into things, man. All right, pretty obvious number one add on the week is going to be Rashad Penny. Finally fully healthy, finally fully involved. Let's take a look over the next 3 weeks for the Seattle Seahawks running back. He's got the LA Rams, the Chicago Bears, and the Detroit Lions. These aren't amazing matchups versus the Rams and the Bears, but nonetheless, they are still good enough matchups that you can plug them in as an RB2 or a flex play on the week. And then we definitely like that week 17 matchup versus Detroit in what should be the fantasy championship for most leagues. So I think Rashad Penny is a must add player, even if you don't need to play him in weeks 15 or 16. If you are at the top of your league, this is still a player you need to consider because the Detroit Lions are one of the worst teams in the league against the run. So Rashad Penny is a phenomenal add. He ended up rushing 16 times for 137 yards and two scores. We know that Pete Carroll has always loved Rashad Penny. We just haven't seen him really get completely implemented into a game plan as well as completely healthy on the season. And now that we have, boy, does he look good. Make Penny your number one waiver addition. Next on the list, we've got Russell Gage of the Atlanta Falcons. He was a must add last week as well. Listen, at this point in the season, this is your number one receiver on the Atlanta Falcons squad. I know it is not the most attractive sounding player, but nonetheless, Russell Gage is a number one receiver. He presents fantasy value, especially in full PPR leagues on a weekly basis. He finished here in week 14 with 4 overall receptions off of 6 targets for 64 receiving yards. He had over 40 receiving yards in the first quarter of this game off of 3 receptions. I thought he was going to actually have a much bigger day overall, but nonetheless, he gets the San Francisco 49ers week 15, the Detroit Lions week 16, then a stiff matchup in the fantasy championship against the Buffalo Bills. But nonetheless, he is a play based off of his overall volume. And the nice thing here is that Matt Ryan, the veteran quarterback, really looks to trust Russell Gage overall. So nonetheless, this is a simple addition. He is seeing the most volume right next to Kyle Pitts. He is playing as a wide receiver one on this Atlanta Falcons team, and therefore he should be rostered. Moving on, we've got Amon-Ra St. Brown. Listen, I was not comfortable in making him a must add last week as he's been completely inconsistent on the season. So there is still a little bit of warning here, but overall, he looks to have kind of secured that number one receiver position for the Detroit Lions. So if you're hurting at the position, he gets Arizona, Atlanta, and Seattle to finish the year. We love that week 16 matchup against Atlanta. It's a little stiff against Arizona in week 15. And then Seattle has actually performed better than you would think, but there's still a favorable enough matchup in the fantasy championship that we can consider adding Amon-Ra St. Brown. He finished with 8 receptions off 12 targets for 73 receiving yards. A pretty solid day overall, coming off of that big performance in week 14. So am I crazy about this ad? Not necessarily, because it's a Lions player and because these Lions receivers have really disappointed us being completely inconsistent on the year. But nonetheless, it looks like Jared Goff has found someone he likes to throw to on a consistent basis. We'll find out make this addition with caution, but nonetheless, he is worth an addition moving into week 15. Moving on, we've got both Justin Jackson as well as Joshua Kelly. We saw Austin Eckler get injured with an ankle injury. We do not know a full timeline here. This is something that we will want to pay attention to day by day amongst injury reports and amongst practices. But nonetheless, we've got Justin Jackson as kind of that PPR type player, that receiving back. We've seen him be very productive at times before when Eckler's been injured. So I like Jackson in full PPR, especially in deeper leagues, but Joshua Kelly is going to be the back who gets it done on the ground. This is a little bit of a gamble, kind of like what we saw with Deonta Foreman and Dontrell Hilliard of the Tennessee Titans. And then when McNichols came back, that kind of ruined that whole thing. But nonetheless, you've got a ground back and you've got a receiving back. Who's going to be the better performer? It depends on the Chargers' overall game plan. They do like to throw the football to the running back position. So we'll find out. It's a little bit of a gamble right now, but I do think that both backs need to be on your week 15 radar. Moving on, we've got Royce Freeman. This is another situation where we saw Rex Burkhead go down, so we're seeing another running back get injured. And this is another situation where day by day, we need to pay attention to injury reports and practices. But nonetheless, with David Johnson out due to COVID-19 protocols and with Rex Burkhead leaving this game, this left some room for Royce Freeman to step up. He rushed the football 11 times for 15 yards, which does not sound good at all. Don't get me wrong, that is very bad. But he did have 6 receptions off 8 targets for 51 receiving yards. He was the RB1 on the day. And listen, I don't love this ad, but if you're in an awful position, if you're in a deeper league, he gets Jacksonville in week 15. He's worth streaming next week. Outside of that, this is probably not a long-term play. So just keep in mind, this is a very short-term play. And we need to pay attention to daily practices as well as the daily injury report to see if this is even worth the play. Moving on, I've got Craig Reynolds of the Detroit Lions. Once again, we just need to continue to monitor the Lions backfield situation. We might end up losing DeAndre Swift for the whole season is the rumor going around, which is completely unfortunate with how incredibly productive he's been on the season. Nonetheless, I'm not sure that Jamal Williams is the guy to get it done. He's also been dealing with COVID-19 issues, and we weren't really sure. There were a lot of names flying around this week on who would be the Lions' primary ball carrier, and it ended up being Craig Reynolds. He had a pretty stiff matchup going up against the Denver Broncos. Nonetheless, off 11 rushes, he had 83 rushing yards, and he caught both of his targets for 16 receiving yards. A pretty solid day overall. He doesn't have the best matchup versus Arizona in week 15, but he will get Atlanta, then Seattle in week 16 and 17. So if he truly does emerge as the number one back for the Detroit Lions, we know that Dan Campbell loves to run the football within this offense, and that week 16 matchup versus Atlanta is amazing. But also that week 17 matchup versus Seattle is amazing. So this is potentially a very off the wall play that could help you win throughout the fantasy playoffs, believe it or not. Are we going to put our trust in a practice squad running back for the Lions here in the 2021 fantasy football season? Maybe, because this year has been so incredibly crazy. So many injuries, so many off the wall plays. Maybe Craig Reynolds helps get you through. Moving on, I've got Braxton Berrios of the New York Jets, who ended up leading the team in targets on Sunday against the New Orleans Saints. This is more of a deep league play, a full PPR league play. But nonetheless, we were looking to see who would step up with both Corey Davis out as well as Rondale Moore out. Really the two best receivers on this team, or at least when healthy, the two most consistent receivers on this team. Berrios did somewhat step up. He gets a vulnerable Miami secondary in week 15, then a vulnerable Jacksonville secondary in week 16, and then another very bad secondary facing Tampa Bay in week 17. So deep leagues, full PPR leagues, take a look at Berrios. I do think he could be worth the addition just based off of the matchups alone. I do also want to bring up Jamison Crowder, who didn't really step up to the plate. 6 overall targets, just 3 receptions for 19 receiving yards on Sunday. But nonetheless, I do expect at some point against those very bad secondaries we just went over that he will step up. He's done it in the past. We know what he's capable of. If he finds the end zone, he's going to put together a nice stat line. He was a very underwhelming play here in week 14, but nonetheless, I do think in weeks 15 through 17, he is another player we can take a look at. Moving on, we've got Alan Lazard. And listen, I'm doing this with caution. I've got MVS brought up as well. MVS was a big play in week 14 for a lot of you guys. And I told you guys I didn't feel great about it because we're constantly chasing that number two guy on the Green Bay Packers offense, the number two guy behind Davante Adams. And year after year, we're just disappointed because it's so entirely inconsistent. The last 2 weeks, it's looked like MVS. I had a lot of questions about MVS this past week. And now it's going to look like Alan Lazard, who ended up bringing in 6 receptions and a touchdown, including 75 receiving yards. And now the Green Bay Packers will face the Baltimore Ravens, the Cleveland Browns, and the Minnesota Vikings. Some pretty bad secondaries overall. So I think the idea of continuing to chase a number two Green Bay Packer receiver will stay active throughout the fantasy playoffs. I still do this with caution. I don't know. If we look at the past couple weeks, look at the last 3 weeks before the bye. 2 points, 0 points, 1 point. And then even before that, 8 points, 0 points, 14 points. It's just a very up and down road for any receiver on this team who is not named Davante Adams. So I would have caution with Alan Lazard and MVS, but they do get some pretty good matchups throughout the fantasy playoffs as well. Last on the list, I've got a quarterback, none other than Taysom Hill, who really, really put up a nice stat line versus the New York Jets. We talked about him as a must-add last week after that week 13 performance versus Dallas, where he threw 4 interceptions, but still put up 20 fantasy points. Are you kidding me? He had 175 passing yards, no passing touchdowns, 73 rushing yards, but 2 rushing touchdowns versus the Jets. I like the upcoming matchups. He's got Tampa Bay, Miami, and Carolina. These are some decent defenses who have been kind of slipping up as of late. So I like where Hill is at. I think that the Saints kind of mentality is to try and win every football game however they can. So I don't think we're going to see intentional losing stretch for the final 3 to 4 weeks of the season for the Saints. I think they're going to give it all they've got versus Tampa Bay and Carolina, especially, and why not Miami as well. So I think Taysom Hill, as the Saints and Hill try and figure out what his role is going to be for the future, this is kind of an audition. I think that Hill is going to continue to show what he can do through the air, but more importantly on the ground, as he looks to be kind of a dual threat quarterback, but definitely a dual threat quarterback. So I think Hill is a great add if you're hurting at the quarterback position. Maybe you lost a Lamar Jackson like me and it lost you your chance of going to the fantasy playoffs. Nonetheless, that's a different story. Add Hill if you're in a bad position. I think he's a great add moving into week 15. And that'll cap off the video, man. I hope you guys enjoyed today's content. If you did, feel free to go ahead and smash that like button down below. Consider joining the Catch Fam today by hitting that sub button down below. Like I said, we have daily uploads as well as daily fantasy Q&A live streams. So we will do everything we absolutely can to get you guys through the fantasy playoffs. We've already had a ton of success here at the channel. And with that, feel free to drop any comments down below pertaining to the 2021 fantasy football season. And please let me know who is your top waiver wire add moving into week 15. With that, I say thank you guys so much for watching and or listening. And remember, Yassad here at The Catch.